Hi students, today we are going to discuss about the topic of compensation management, which is otherwise known as the remuneration. So we are going to discuss about its introduction, the objectives, then the factors, components, importance, and then finally the conclusion. So coming into the introduction part, so first we let us know the meaning of the compensation. It is defined as the sum of money that an employer pays to an employee for providing a service to the organization. Say for example, this compensation in other terms we'll collectively we use to say as a salary. So it is not only the salary alone is a compensation for the service which is rendered for the organization. There is other term like we have to say monetary as well as non-monetary systems. Here we'll have the two important components. One is the monetary and non-monetary pay where we provide for the employees. It is the money received in performance of the work and the benefits that an organization provides to their employees. So let us have the objectives, see into the objectives. What is the main motive of this compensation is? It gives the employee the motivation. The main thing is it is a motivating factors which will increase the performance of the employee. That is usually we say the efficiency of the employees depends on the motivating factors. So this compensation is a main motivation for the employees, and it will retain the employees in an organization, and it will increase the morale and as well as the loyalty of the employee towards the organization. And it determines the basic wage and salary. Here, when coming into the wage and salary, this two terms are different. We usually say the wage as a fixed one, the wage is a variable pay, and the salary as a fixed one. So usually we pay the salary for a month for the employees and for the wage on hourly basis. So which we have, if an employee is worked as 8 hours in a worker is working in an industry, and so probably it is a manufacturing industry, then here we'll say the workers has to be paid the wages. Whereas in the company, if an employee is working for a month base, and this salary is a fixed one. So it is usually paid for the employees, and wage will be usually paid for the laborers in a manufacturing industry. Then it will be a reward for the job which he is going to be performed. The next objective is it is a reward. So here we will be giving the employees a reward in terms of monetary as well as in terms of non-monetary wise. Then coming into the next part, the most important thing which is affecting the compensation is we are dividing it into an external and as an internal. So the external means the outside components which is affecting the compensation structure, and internal which is inside the organization. So here the first thing, the foremost thing is demand and supply of the labor. So what we say here, if the employee are less and the demand for the workers is more, then here the compensation will be expected more. Say for example, if demand for the particular post is high and the supply of the employees for the particular post is very less, then in this case, the demand of the compensation will be more from the employer's side. So this is the main factor we have to concentrate in the compensation while we fixing the compensation for the employees. Then the cost of living. Here what we say is if the cost of living will be different from different places and regions and countries. So in the underdeveloped nation, the cost of living will be more. Hence, the wages are very high. Whereas, if they are expected to live with less facilities, while on the other hand, the developed nations are having the higher wages. Say, for example, if the wage system for the Bangalore will be very high when compared to the Coimbatore. Since the cost of living in Bangalore will be high, and it is a developed place and developed region where they will be expecting more compensation. So this compensation, while fixing the compensation, we have to concentrate on this cost of living. Then the comparative wages. So what do you mean by comparative wages? It is the it depends on the pay system of the our competitive companies. So the competitive industry should have the same wage system. So there should be a comparative wages where we have to compare with our competitors. Then the labor unions. Here, when we compare in the labor union, it is a trade union or a strong. When the wages paid to the workers are high because the trade union pressurizes the employers to meet the demand of workers and give them higher wages. So the bargaining capacity of the labor union has to be concentrated when we are fixing the compensation. Then the most important, apart from all these factors, we have to concentrate on the government rules and regulations. The regulations which have to be followed during the wage determinations so that the workers can get minimum wages to maintain a good living for themselves and their family members. So the government amendments has to be focused when we are going for the compensation. Then coming into the internal factors, the compensation policy of the company, then the organization ability to pay for its employees. Then we all know the job analysis, the most important factor. Getting the task to be done. The job analysis coming into the job description, that is the title of the job or the position, has to be affected by this compensation plan. Then the most important one is employee efficiency. It is the potential of the employee has to be noticed or evaluated when you are fixing the compensation factors. Then coming into the next, the most important topic is compensation components. So here we are dividing the compensation component into two categories, mainly the monetary and the non-monetary. What do you mean by monetary? Monetary, which is in terms of money, which is the compensation is based on the money, then it is called monetary. Then non-monetary, the other rewards, or it may be some other benefits that the employee will get in accordance to their work, then it is called as a non-monetary. Then in the monetary system, you have direct and indirect components. What is meant by direct? So which is paid directly. Say for example, we'll have the basic pay, the base pay, or otherwise called as the basic pay. Then the bonus, you know, the basic salary, compensation or the compensation structure is divided into many components. The first foremost component is the base pay, so which is otherwise called as the basic pay. It is a fundamental component of the pay structure. It is a major portion of the compensation. So here, when we divide the gross salary of a person, then the basic pay will be very, very important and is the major portion of the compensation. So this basic pay will be 40% of the gross salary, minimum 40% of the gross salary, maximum up to 60% or above. It depends upon the organization. Okay, then this basic salary, the other structure or other components like the bonus, incentives, all these are depends on the basic pay of the salary. Then the next coming into the bonus. So you all know what is meant by bonus. Bonus is given to the workers as a share of the organization profits in a particular year. If an organization is getting more profit or it is getting more productivity and the sales is getting increased, then as a share of it, it is dividing its profit and giving it in the terms of bonus to the employees. Then you all know the what is meant by incentives. Incentives, it is a very important component, which is a motivating factor. It improves the efficiency and productivity of the organization. It is apart from the regular wages. If an, say for example, if a marketing guy, he is performing more and he is achieving his target, then he will be giving us a incentives as a motivating factors. Then here the most important one is the perks. The one of the component of the compensation is perks or prerequisites. So this perks, it depends upon the position of the employee in an organization. This perks, it is not mandatory for all the employees. It depends upon the employee position in a particular organization. Example of some of the perks will be, sometimes the employee will be given paid holidays, then transportation subsidies, then flexible time for working or work from home, whatever may be. Then free food will be given in an organization for the employees. These are some of the examples of the perks. So this is all about the direct compensation. Then we are coming into the indirect compensation, like it is like insurance, the leave, holidays, or the sick holidays, the personal holidays, casual leaves. Then sometimes the organization will be giving clothes for its employees, then company parties, then laptops will be provided for the employees, then retirement programs, etc., etc. Then coming into the next, the non-monetary. It is not only the employee will be happy or he will be very satisfied if only they are given only the monetary benefits. Apart from that, they have to be motivated with other non-monetary type of compensation, like certifications from their work which they are performing, then the social relationship, then resources. What are the sufficient resources has to be allocated for the employees, and then the leadership which they are expecting, that is the support which are they are expecting from their higher officials and then management, and then psychological health and intellectual growth. So these are the non-monetary benefits. So apart from the money, they are expecting all these type of compensation from the organization. And coming into the other components, which is very very essential for framing a salary slip or salary structure. These are the most important. The basic, as I already said, it should be minimum 40% of the gross salary. Then the allowances. Here when we talk about the allowances, we have many allowances like dearness allowances, house rent allowances. Then you'll be having the leave, LTA, leave travel allowances, then medical allowances, then mobile allowances, children education allowances, then hostel allowances, etc., etc. So this all depends upon the organization, their way of affordability to the employees. So these are the, some of the income from the salaries. Then prerequisites, already I told you, it is otherwise called as perks, which depends upon the employee's position in an organization. If the employee is holding a high position, he will be given more prerequisites or perks. Okay. Then all these things, advanced salary, leave enhancement, every many incomes are coming from the salary. So we are going to discuss the most important as one by one. So here you all know about Employees State Insurance Scheme, ESI. So this ESI, it is applicable. It is very common to the wages, to the workers who are working in a factory system. So usually in a company, mainly they are not providing this ESI. Some companies it depends upon, but it is mandatory for the manufacturing industries. So the applicability of this act is employee should have earn rupees 21,000 as a gross salary. If your employee is getting a gross salary of 21,000, then he is eligible for this ESI. So this ESI, it is for the social security purpose of a worker. This it covers the benefits like sickness benefits, maternity benefit, disablement benefit, dependents benefits, medical benefits, and funeral expenses. So next we coming into this ESI. There are two contributions. One is the employer contribution and another one is the employee contribution. So the employer contribution is 3.25% and the employee contribution is 0.75%. The important note is here this ESI will be contributed from the gross salary. Okay, so this is very important. Please note down this. This will be deducted from the employee gross salary. Okay, the employer will be giving 3.25% and the employee will be giving 0.75%. So this next important component is you all know about PF, that is the Provident Fund. So here this Provident Fund will be it is calculated from the basic salary of the employee. As I already said, this the salary components are divided into many sub-components like basic, DA, HRA, allowances, other allowances, etc. So this basic, where this basic salary, it is like a minimum 40% of gross will have to be maintained in a salary. Then from the PF will be calculated from the basic salary, that is 12%. So employee contribution should be 12% and the employer contribution is again 12%, which is from the basic salary. Okay, so when you are calculating the PF, you have to calculate from the basic salary of the salary component. Then coming into this gratuity, this it is mainly for the employees who are providing a long period of service in an organization like 5 years and above. So he is eligible for the gratuity. So here this gratuity is a time of superannuation. That is that it is if you retire at the age of 58, when you retire at any other age in between, then you are unfortunately you are resigning the job or you are in the event of death, then this gratuity will be given for the employees. The minimum qualification is he should serve for the organization at least a minimum period of 5 years and above can be eligible for getting this gratuity. So this is the formula for calculating is, that is every completed 5 years of experience service into 15 days of wage or salary. So this 15 days wage salary should be the last earned salary. And it should not exceed rupees 3,50,000 as per the act. Okay, then coming into the next component, this is very important, professional tax PTA. So this is collected once in a 6 months. So here also this professional tax, it depends upon the states in which the employee is working. It will be differ from one state to another state. So next slide we will discuss about the professional tax slab. So up to 21,000 is not eligible for the PTA. So from 21,000 to 30,000, it will be 135 rupees. So this 21,000, it is the gross salary of the employee over a period of 6 months. Okay. So this is all about this slab. So if he is coming under this slab, any other slab, this particular rupees will be deducted from his salary as a PTA. So this is a sample salary slip. So here the gross salary, here you have to notice the two important component. One is the gross pay, another one is net pay. You have to have a difference between these two, gross and net pay. So here the gross pay is the total emoluments of the salary, that is the salary remuneration or salary or remuneration, whatever may be. So when this, after this all these deduction has been made, so this net salary will otherwise called as a take home. It is all otherwise called as a take home. So here the employee gross salary is 25,600, where this basic pay, how we have to calculate the basic pay, it is the minimum 40% of the gross salary. So here it is above 60%, so it is up to the company wish, but it should be minimum 40%. So from the gross, we are taking 60% as a basic pay, and the house rent allowance is 3,000. The employee is giving, the employer is giving his employee the allowance of rupees 3,000 per month, and the DNS allowance, it is like it depends upon the region in which the organization, if the employee is working. So if he it will be varying from one region to the another region according to the price level of the economy. So this DNS allowance, it is 7,500 here. The medical allowances is giving, they are giving 100 rupees. So the total is 25,600. So in the left side of the column, you are having all the remuneration which is given by the organization. So in the right side, you will have the deductions, like you will have the professional tax. So here the professional tax, they are coming and they are deducting 200 for 6 months. Then general provident fund PF is 4,000 rupees. Then they are deducting the life insurance corporation. The company is providing the insurance for the employee. For that, they are deducting 5,000. Then postal life insurance, 240 rupees. Group insurance, 150 rupees. And income tax TDS is 1,000 rupees. So to total, all over the deduction is 10,890. So this has to be deducted from the gross salary. And finally, you are getting the net salary. So these are the components. The basic components is coming under the left side column. So this is a model salary slip, how we have to calculate the structure of the salary and what are the deductions, and this while we deducting the components, we have to strictly follow the government rules and regulations and the amendments which is coming on the yearly basis. Okay, next is the importance. Here when you're coming into the importance of compensation, so as we already discussed, you all know about job description. Job description is all about the job title, the position which you are going to handle. So everything depends upon the job description, and from the job description we have to evaluate the employee's performance, and based on the job evaluation you have to structure your components. So like you have to have a pay structure like basic, DA, HRA, LTA, like that. So that structure has to be framed, which we discussed in the previous slide in the salary components. Then based on the salary survey, the salary has to be revised according to the government norms and amendments. Okay, this is all about the importance of the compensation. Then when coming into the concluding part, So this compensation, it is very, very important for each and every employee, which will be a motivating factor for enhancing their productivity and enhancing their skills, etc. So which will be increasing the productivity of the organization, and based on the rewards, bonus and schemes, everything has to be framed in the compensation, and it is compulsory for every organization to strictly concentrate on this part in order to make the employee to be motivated. So this is all about the compensation. Thank you.